Echa Yashva Vadod Ha'ir Abosiyam Ha'yisa Kalmano Rabosi Vagoyim Sarosi Bamedinois Ha'yisa Lomas Bachoy Sivke Balailo Vedimosa Alechayo Ein Loh Menachem Mikol Oyhaveho Koroy Eha Bogaduva Hoyulo Loyavim Golisa Yehuda Meoini Meroy Vabodo He Yoshevo Vagoyim Loimoteo Monoya Koroy de fell is a good hob and hammets or rim. Dache tia in abelois. Mibli boye moyed. Kosio rea shoy me min. Koyane ho nenochim. Pusuloy se honugois. Vehim arlo. Ho you. Tare holy roish. Ayave ho shalu.
She's trying to reestablish. I have not become blinded to the fact that I love these children.
Torah is not burnt and lost. Torah is driven deep into another dimension.
The Beis Hamikdash is not something that was destroyed. It is being destroyed and redestroyed.
That's going up, because the person is investing in his future. He's building his future.
Echa Yoiv Be'apoy Adonoy es Bastiyoin Hishlich Mishamayim Eretz Tiferes Yisrael Rozochar Hadoim Raglov B'yoim Apoy Bila Adonoy V'loy Choma.
One of the great rabbis once commented that the pattern that we have for the public mourning over the destruction of the temple is diametrically the opposite of the type of mourning we observe for private bereavements. When, God forbid, someone loses a close relative, a spouse, a parent, a child, the laws of Avelos, the laws of mourning, initially start very, very stringently. During the 7 days, the Avel does not even leave his house. And then there are restrictions for 30 days, 23 days after Shiva. And then for a parent, at least, there are restrictions, much more limited, for an entire year. But gradually, the trajectory of Avelot is starting off very, very severe, and then petering off. By contrast, when we have Avelot mourning for the destruction of the Beit HaMikdash, we start off gradually easy. During the 3 weeks, there are certain restrictions. Then we get to the 9 days, Rosh Chodesh Av. It becomes stricter, and then we have the week of Tisha B'Av, and then we have Erev Tisha B'Av, culminating in Tisha B'Av, which is the most severe of any of those days. So in short, private mourning goes from the chamor to the kal, from the heavy to the lenient. Public mourning over the destruction of the temple starts off from the lenient, and it culminates into the much more severe and strict. Why is there a reversal of the trajectory? Why is the pattern diametrically the opposite? And the explanation that is given is that the function of mourning halachically and psychologically are for two opposite reasons. When a person, God forbid, is confronted with a private bereavement, their world is shattered. They have no inner peace. They feel they cannot go on. And part of the purpose of the laws of mourning is to get the person gradually accustomed to re-enter society so that eventually they will be able to be comforted, be able to be strong, be able to contribute. Starts off very, very severe, and we gradually get the person accustomed to be able to become a regular person again. The pain never heals, but it can be compartmentalized, put in a certain part of your brain, part of your consciousness, so you're able to go on. By contrast, When it comes to the mourning over the Beis HaMikdash, we have the opposite problem. How many of us are shattered because of the Chorban Beis HaMikdash? How many of us even understand what it means? Perhaps the first generation that experienced the Chorban, that remembered the temple, that remembered God's presence on earth in that way, perhaps they could appreciate the magnitude of the loss. But we are the opposite. Can a person who was born deaf understand the beauty of music? Can a person who was born blind understand the beauty of color? We've just never had it. We've never experienced it. We've never seen it. We don't know what it is. So the purpose of Avelos is not to heal a shattered consciousness so we can gradually go about our regular life. It's the opposite. To make us understand, at least by external behaviors, what it is that we've lost. To make our heart shattered, to give us the sadness, to give us the introspection. And therefore, the purpose of Avelot over the Chorban Beis HaMikdash is not to take us out of our misery, it is to put us into a misery that we otherwise would not feel. A man once went to the great Hasidic Rebbe, the Sfas Emes, and said, "What can I do if I can't cry over the destruction of the Beis HaMikdash?" And the Sfas Emes answered, and this is an answer that's true for virtually all of us, if one is incapable of crying over the destruction of the Beis HaMikdash, then we must cry over our own souls that are so impoverished that we don't even know what the Beis HaMikdash represented. We cry over ourselves. In reality, the Beis HaMikdash was not just a building. It was not just magnificent architecture, which of course it was. But the Beis HaMikdash was a symbol of God's presence existing within the heart and the soul of the Jewish people. When the first Beis HaMikdash, it was not in Jerusalem, but the traveling tabernacle of the Midbar, of the desert, was constructed, when God gave Moshe the command, God said, "V'yosu li mikdash, make for me a sanctuary, v'shachanti b'socham, so I will dwell in their midst." And Chazal tell us it does not say God dwells in the temple or the Mishkan, but God dwells in the heart and soul of every Jewish person who makes their heart and soul a dwelling place for the divine. And when Klal Yisrael is no longer able to make their heart and soul a dwelling place for the divine, when there is no longer v'shachanti b'socham, then there is no temple. The temple just becomes a building. And like any building, it can be destroyed. When King Nebuchadnezzar destroyed the first temple, the temple of Shlomo HaMelech, he was so proud and arrogant of his accomplishment. He said, "I destroyed the house of God. I banished God from his temple. I am more powerful than the Almighty." But God responded to him, "I was not living there anymore. You ground up flour that was already ground. You cut up something that was already cut up, because my presence will not be in that temple if my presence is not in the heart and soul of the Jewish people." And therefore, the real date the temple was destroyed was not necessarily the 9th of Av, paradoxically, but it was some unknown date where after the culmination of centuries, God's presence was no longer in the heart and soul of Am Yisrael. And this is what we mourn. We don't mourn a building. We have magnificent architecture in the world today. We mourn the diminution of a relationship, the lack of intimacy, the lack of connection, the lack of open and revealed love that the Beis HaMikdash represented. I say open and revealed because, in point of fact, it is important for a Jew to know that God's love is still here and God's love is still strong. And God mourns and cries and sobs and weeps over the galut even much more so than we do ourselves. But it is hidden. It is not apparent. And if it is true, as the saying goes, absence makes the heart grow fonder, this is a time in which our profound yearning for redemption and connection can actually create a deep, deep bond with the Almighty as both of us yearn together for the return of His divine presence to Jerusalem, to Eretz Yisrael, to the world, but ultimately to our own hearts and our own souls, because from there it will spread. The Talmud Yerushalmi tells us that every generation in which the Beis HaMikdash is not rebuilt is as guilty as the generation of the Churban. Meaning, when we read that the temple was destroyed because of this sin and that sin, and I'll get to that in a moment, and we think to ourselves, okay, those were the sins of the past, and we don't have the merit to get the temple back, but we're not guilty of those sins. The Talmud Yerushalmi says the opposite. If we wouldn't be equally guilty of those very same sins, the temple would be rebuilt. If it's not rebuilt, we are equivalent to the generation of its destruction. To put it another way, somewhat graphically, the Beis HaMikdash is not something that was destroyed. It is being destroyed and redestroyed every single day that it is not rebuilt. It is as if we are walking by a Beis HaMikdash that is in flames today, yesterday. If we're not zochet to the Binyan Beis HaMikdash tomorrow, we hope, God willing, that tomorrow we will have a Beis HaMikdash. Every single day we don't have it is a new Churban. Because if we wouldn't be guilty of those averus, it would be here now. Based on this, our whole avoda during the 3 weeks culminating in Tisha B'Av is to ask ourselves the question, how do we rebuild the Beis HaMikdash? And the way we rebuild the Beis HaMikdash is not necessarily by taking the Temple Mount by force of arms. The Rambam says, after all, that the Beis HaMikdash will not physically be rebuilt until Mashiach comes. And Rashi goes even further, based on Midrashim. Rashi says the third Beis HaMikdash is not supposed to be built by human effort at all. It's going to be rebuilt. It'll come from the Shamayim. So when we talk about building a Beis HaMikdash, we are not talking about mitzidenu, from our perspective, any type of physical building. But the way we build the Beis HaMikdash is by bringing God into our heart and into our soul, by making ourselves, in the words of the famous statement of the Sefer Charedim, Bilvavi Mishkon Evnech, in my heart I will build a tabernacle and dwelling place for God. And if enough of us build within our hearts and our souls a dwelling place for the Almighty, then indeed the Beis HaMikdash Shalmala from Shemayim will come down. This is our Abayda. Build the Mishkan of God in our heart and in our soul. Chazal, with their Ruach HaKodesh, give us insight that we are not capable of coming up with ourselves. It would be pretentious and foolish for any one of us to talk about why the temple was destroyed and why the temple is not rebuilt. But fortunately, we do not have to express our personal opinions on this. Our sages have given us compelling reasons. Our sages have told us in Maseches Yuma that the first temple was destroyed because of the cardinal sins of idolatry, sexual immorality, and murder, the big three, the worst of Eros, for which a Jew must give up his life before he transgresses. But the second temple, the temple that was destroyed by the Romans in the year 70, our sages tell us, and of course they actually lived during that era, that Jews were largely Torah observants. They kept the commandments. They studied the Torah. They were not guilty of murder, sexual immorality, and idolatry. So why was the second temple destroyed? And our sages say, because of the needless, groundless hatred and polarization that existed among Am Yisrael, in which there were so many groups and subgroups, and as the Nitziv explains, each group looked down at the other group, thinking either, as we say, those who are to the right of me, those who are more religious than me, are fanatics, and those to the left of me are heretics and apikorsim. It is only where I am that is right. And we looked at other Jews, and we looked at them as inferior, and we looked at them as heretical, and we looked at them as not having value. And that was the cause of the Chorban of the Second Temple. And the Gemara says, come and look, that the first temple that was destroyed for the worst averos of idolatry, sexual immorality, and murder, that whole period of exile only lasted 70 years. And the second Chorban, that was because of the sin of hatred, machlokas, dissension among the Jewish people, is a golos that even in the time of the Gemara had already been a long time, and we can superimpose almost 1,500 years onto that. See what sinas chinam is. And we look at the Jewish world today, and we look at ourselves today, and we say, well, they had sinas chinam. But as the Talmud Yerushalmi says, if the temple is not rebuilt, it is because the generation still has the Aveira. Sinas chinam is not necessarily throwing rocks. It's not necessarily insulting. It's not necessarily openly denigrating. Sinas chinam can exist in cold forms as well as hot forms. It can be indifference. It can be looking at people as they're inferior because they're not part of your group. They're not part of your comfort level. And as Rav Kook Zatzal remarked, if the Beis HaMikdash was destroyed because of Sinas Chinam, we can only rebuild it when we have unconditional love for every single Jew. To open our hearts, open our homes, to try to see the good in people. And as Shlomo HaMelech said, the human soul is like a reflecting pool of water. Kamayim apanim alpanim, kein leiv ha'adam li'adam. When you look at water and it reflects your face, when you smile with kindness, you get back a kind and gracious smile, your own. When you frown with anger, that is the face you get back. So Shlomo HaMelech said, so too is the heart of one human being to another human being. We relate to our fellow Jew with kindness, compassion, and understanding to see their goodness, even if they're not necessarily holding where we would like them to hold. You can rest assured, says the wisest of all men, that they will see the goodness in what you represent as well. And ultimately, you will be able to bring that person also to Torah, to Yiddishkeit, to love and respect the Torah, which is a vehicle of that type of love. We've suffered so much in this galus. We've suffered physically. We've suffered spiritually. We yearn and we desire this galus to end. But it's not going to end until we can overcome the reason for this galus in the first place. May Hashem give us the strength to learn to be lovers and not haters, to learn to generate light and not just curse the darkness. And in that way, we've taken a giant step towards building the Mishkan of the heart. And if enough of us build the Mishkan of the heart, we will have that glorious day of that third Beis HaMikdash coming down min HaShemayim.
Eis komeis Yaakov horas bebrosoi mivtzerei vas Yehuda higia loretz chilel mamlocho besorehom. Godav v'chariyav, koil keren Yisrael, Hayeshiva chol.
Tisha B'Av, special time, sad time, time of destruction. But there's an interesting question about Tisha B'Av that's raised by the Arizal, the great Kabbalistic master, which bears thought. He asks this question. You know that on Tisha B'Av the morning is lighter in the afternoon. In the afternoon, after midday, we no longer sit on the floor, we can sit on normal chairs. In fact, running throughout the whole of Tisha B'Av is a theme of festival. We call it a moed, it is a festival. It has an overtone of festival, but particularly in the afternoon, when the morning is less intense than in the early part of the day. The Arizal asks a question which really should be obvious to anyone. And that question is, why are we mourning less in the afternoon? If anything, we should be mourning more intensely. Our history of the events of the destruction of the temple tells us that the temple burnt in the afternoon. On the contrary, the morning was when the destruction began, but the fires were lit in the afternoon, and the temple burned through the afternoon and through the night and the next day. In fact, there were people who fasted for 2 days. So the real manifestation of destruction was the afternoon of Tisha B'Av. And therefore, if anything, the morning should gather intensity. We don't do that. We mourn less in the afternoon. This is a question. This is a problem. The answer to this is very cryptic. The answer is, says the Arizal, that our sages tell us that the reason we have a beginning of rejoicing, so to speak, at least a lessening of the morning, some vision of hope in the afternoon, is because the blessing, if you like, or the mitigation of the tragedy, is that the temple burnt, and in burning the temple was a manifestation of the fact that we were not being destroyed, but only a building. In other words, the language in the sages is sticks and stones, bricks and mortar, you might say. An edifice, a building, was burning, and Hashem's anger, God's anger, is taken out on the building and the inanimate, and rather than on the Jewish people. This is a very strange answer. Very strange answer. I mean, what are we talking about? In human terms, this would be somebody venting his anger on something that is a sublimation, right? Instead of showing your anger against the person you're angry with, you go and you show it in some peripheral fashion. But obviously, there's something much deeper here. What is the message? Another question we can ask is this. And these ideas come from Moshe Shapira, right, who put it this way. You know that Gittin, the tractate of divorce, is really where our sources are for the destruction of the temple. And it's very appropriate, obviously, we're talking about a separation. And there, the halachic point is raised that a get needs to have 12 lines. A Jewish bill of divorce needs to have 12 lines. Why is this? Because in between every book of the Bible, every book of the Torah, 5 books of the Torah, we have 4 lines of separation. That means 4 blank lines in the text. And so we have 12 lines that are constituting separations in Torah, essence of reality being the Torah, and Torah is separated into sections, and the sections have 12 lines in total between them. The obvious difficulty with this is, that anybody who has any beginning of mathematical knowledge knows, that if you have 5 books separated, you have 4 separations. And 4 separations of 4 lines is 16 lines, and not 12 lines. So this is an obvious question, and Tosfos asked this question. Why are the books of the Torah separated by 16 lines, and we reckon them as 12? Says Tosfos something very mysterious, that the last 2 books, the separation is not real. Bamidbar Devarim, that's really not a not a separation. Bamidbar runs into Devarim, and we don't count the separation. Devarim, which is said by Moshe Rabbeinu, the way Tosfos puts it is that's a repetition of what occurs before. The Ten Commandments are repeated. Many other things are repeated in the so-called Deuteronomy, the repeated or second book. And since that 5th book of the Torah is really a repetition of what comes before, it cannot be considered separate, and therefore we don't register that separation. Very strange. What does this mean? What are we being taught here about the book of Devarim? That is in fact a separate book, and yet somehow doesn't suffer from the same schism that the rest of Torah does. Next question. We know that when we read Eicha, we read Jeremiah's Jeremiad, his description of the awesome tragedy and horrific destruction. We know that he ends on a very, very depressing and very destructive note, right? Katzafta aleinu ad moed Hashem, you have been exceedingly angry with us. And it ends on that note of destruction. And we don't wish to end on such a note. And so when we read the Megillah of Eicha, we go back and repeat a verse of hope, right? We add in, we back up, we read the final verse of destruction, and then we back up to a note of hopefulness. But this is very strange. If the text ends on a note of destruction, why don't we end on that note? Who are we to modify what Jeremiah said? The prophet Jeremiah comes along and he gives us a prophetic utterance and it ends on a note of destruction. And the Jewish people, we modify that. What do? We don't read it like that. We end with a destruction and then we back up and add a verse of consolation. What does this mean? If it was good enough for him, why isn't it good enough for us? Why do we need to modify it in that fashion? Why are we able, let me put the question this way, why are we able to end with consolation when Jeremiah was not? Right? That is the question. Let's attempt to answer these questions with a principle. The principle is that when the destruction of the temple took place, Jewish history moved phases. Right? There was a transition in phase. We moved from the phase of the written law, manifest in the temple, prophecy, open revelation. We moved into the beginning of the phase of the oral law. We moved from written to oral, from prophetic to non-prophetic revelations. Let me put it to you this way. We know that Hashem's description of His greatness, we have three classic expressions of that. Hakel, Hagodol, Hagibor, Vahanoira. Gadol, Gibor, Nora. Godol, great, Gibor, mighty, Nora, awesome. Jeremiah did not say the third word. The word awesome, Nora, he did not say that. Why? Because when you're talking about a destruction of the temple, with the enemies of the Jewish people cavorting in the temple, where's Nora? Where's the quality of Nora? Where's awesomeness being manifest then? It's not being manifest. And there's a rule in Jewish expression, you may only state a praise of God that is relevant at the time. You want to use a midah to describe how he manifests. You use a midah only that is current. And if Nora is not current, the temple is lying in ruins, the non-Jewish enemies are cavorting in the temple and celebrating their victory, where's Nora? The deep meaning here is that Nora, the quality of Noira, is the quality of the Beis HaMikdash. The awesomeness of Hashem is manifest in the world there. The Arizal points out that the word Nora is a reversal of the word Aron. The Aron is the place, right? When Yaakov Avinu, who represents Torah, sleeps there, he says, Ma Noira HaMakom Hazeh. How awesome is this place? I, who represent Torah, I should have realized that. How awesome is this place? Noira. Noira is Aron. He was sleeping on the place of the Aron. The Aron is the ark where the Torah is contained in the temple. And therefore, the quality of the temple, where Hashem manifests openly, is called Nora. That's the quality of Noira. Jeremiah says he cannot apply that praise. It's not current. Noira, awesomeness, is not current. Hashem is, so to speak, exiled, banished from the world. That's what it says about Jeremiah. But the men of the great assembly, who lived after the era of prophecy, hechziru atara liyoshna, they returned the crown to its place. And they said the word. And so today we say, Akeil HaGodol HaGibor V'Neira. And the question is very obvious here. Jeremiah, Jeremiah could not say that word because the temple was lying in ruins, and we say it. Is the temple not still ruined? How do we say that word? And here is the key to understand this whole issue. Here's the key, and here's the key to hopefulness. When the temple's destroyed and the revealed phase of Torah passes into hiding and all that destruction manifests, there's a remarkable Jewish consequence or response. And that is, the temple being destroyed drives Torah into a different dimension. It drives Torah that first manifests as a written Torah. It drives that Torah into an oral law, which is inscribed on the hearts and minds of the sages of the Jewish people. And therefore, this consolation of the temple being destroyed, when it's a building that is destroyed, the meaning is that sticks and stones, mortar and brick is destroyed. But Torah replaces, moves. Torah migrates, if you like, into a different locus, into the temple that is the Jewish heart and mind. And we move into the phase of the oral law. The meaning of the destruction of the temple, for all its awesome destruction and pain, the significance here is that Torah is not burnt and lost. Torah is driven deep into another dimension. It moves into the book, let's call it the book of Dvarim, the book in which Moshe Rabbeinu himself utters of his own accord, utters Torah. That's not a separation. That book cannot be called a separation. This is where the human begins to manifest Torah. And that plays itself out later in history as the second phase of history, where the men of the great assembly become the receivers and the locus and the place of Torah in the world. And so we move from the written Torah into the oral Torah. And the significance of the morning becoming lighter is that as the temple burns and the sticks, the mortar and brick is destroyed, at that moment, there's a consolation. The consolation is that the Torah has taken up a new residence. That residence is in one way much deeper than the one that it occupied before. Before, you had to be pure to hear that voice. And Nora manifested openly. But now Noira manifests in a different way. As the Anshek Nesis Agdele say, the Noira, the awesomeness of God's manifestation in the world, is that He holds Himself back and leaves us the independence. Yes, leaves independence for enemies to destroy, but also leaves the place of independence for us to create our own Torah. And the greatness of the oral law is that we create it. We move from the phase of written, where we have to be able to receive it, to the phase where we create it. And in one way that is far preferable, as the Talmud says, Chacham Adif Minavi, a wise person, a person who can generate Torah in that dimension, is greater than a prophet. And therefore, Jeremiah ended on a note of destruction because he's the world of prophecy. He ends on Katzavta Aleinu Ad Moed. He talks about the destruction. That is what he is. His mode is prophecy. But we can add a verse of consolation. We who live in the dimension of the oral law, we who see another side, we who generate the ability to create Torah of ourselves, of our own accord, small though it may be compared to the manifestation of prophecy. But nevertheless, this is the ongoing meaning of Torah, which will take us through to a messianic age. And so Yirmiyah did not add a verse of consolation. He's talking about the generation of destruction. But we who live in the recreation of Torah, we add the verse of consolation. That's exactly what we do. If you like, this is parallel to Moshe Rabbeinu, Moses being shown all of Jewish history, and he sees Rabbi Akiva. And Rabbi Akiva is talking about a Torah that Moshe Rabbeinu cannot understand. How can the giver of Torah not understand a dimension of Torah? The answer is he lives in a dimension of Torah that is given clearly. There's nothing that needs to be fathomed and figured out for yourself. He can't relate to that. But it's Rabbi Akiva. Akiva, same letters as Yaakov. Source of Torah in that way, who ushers in a new era of Torah, and that is the Torah of the oral law. And therefore, the message here is that when Yaakov Avinu sleeps at night and perceives the place of Oren, is really perceiving the beginning of a night that will follow in history, where the temple will be destroyed, will enter a nighttime, will enter the afternoon and night of a Tisha B'Av, which is intensifying darkness. The building will burn then, but in that very burning is the seed of consolation. Namely, that Torah moves from an openly manifest dimension into the hidden dimension, but the creative dimension, the ongoing and eternal dimension of the Jewish heart and mind.
Dorach kashtoi k'yev Nitzav yeminoi k'tzor Vaya aharoi g'kol Machamadei oyin Be'oi hel bastiyoin Shofach koesh.
Dovid HaMelech says in Tillim, Ki oragnu alecha kol hayom, because of our failings, Klal Yisrael will too often in history be in a mode of having to be meisa nefesh, of having to be self-sacrificial. It's a result of them not having utilized the resources, the opportunities that had been given to them in history. Rashba says, what does it mean, kol hayom? He asks. You can only be meisa nefesh, give your life one time. Says the Rashba that it means the readiness to give your life. When a Jew recites Kriya Shema, other Mephoshim similarly weigh in with this idea that the preparedness, and they cite in fact that Rabbi Akiva, when he was Meisa Nefesh in reality, said that he was waiting for this opportunity. When was he waiting for it? When he said in Kriya Shema, Bechol Nafshecho, he has that preparedness. And the Sefer Achsidim, others indicate that that preparedness, if it's done with a full heart by Jews enough times in history, can be in place of the actual Mesiras Nefesh, which tragically enough does surface at junctures that turn out to be our nemesis. Klal Yisrael, the Gemara and Gitin, Reb Tzadik says, it's not accidental that the most intensive reporting of these moments of self-sacrifice and retribution of destruction appear in the tractate of Gitin, when Klal Yisrael, as it were, are being sent away from HaKadosh Baruch Hu, distanced, removed, temporarily, but for that moment there is a removal. And the perek in Gitin is perek anizokin, perek of suffering, of damages, of liability. One such gemara there says, a woman and her seven sons, and it reports that they're being coerced, pressured into Mesiras Nefesh, to give their lives or serve idolatry. Each one comes forward, seven sons, each one individually, and recites his own verse, his own pasuk, and refuses to go Mesiras Nefesh. The Marsha, others, take note of this. Why does each one quote a different pasuk? So some of the mafoshim give it a nuance of its different facets of the trial of the Avodah Zarah. It's the Yediyas Hashem, knowing the Ribbono Hashem, Yichud Hashem, the knowing the oneness of God, the Avas Hashem, and they go through it accordingly. Masha also suggests that it happened on subsequent days during the course of a week, and these verses can be correlated with the Shir Shel Yom in the course of the week. Perhaps there's another possibility that we might suggest, is that Mesiras Nefesh, being self-sacrificial, martyrdom, can happen at times for the wrong reasons. People can get, as we say in the idiom of the lingua franca, they can get psyched up. Jonestown, people can be Mesir Nefesh, or they can give Teira reports, L'maylech, they give their children, lo aleinu, for Avodah Zarah, themselves, their children. So somebody's willingness to die for a cause is not going to be the arbiter of whether or not that cause is true. To wit, our cousins today, who unfortunately in much of the naive and the world who wants to be naive, the mere fact of Mesiras Nefesh is in itself ipso facto sufficient proof that they must have some cause that has some justification. Untrue. History is replete, filled with people who were Mesir Nefesh, sacrificed their lives, martyred them for nonsense. There's a Yetzer Hara. There is a kind of a subliminal satisfaction that somebody has at the moment of martyrdom, which, is it imbalanced? We think yes. So what's different about our Mesiras Nefesh? Mefarshim point out that the Ki Oragno Olecha Kol Hayom is Begematria Yisrael. There's something unique about Jewish martyrdom. Perhaps that's the message, that why each boy brings his own verse, his own pasuk. Each one had to make his analysis. Is this my obligation or isn't it? Is there a justifiable reason to take that life that the Ribbono Shelem gave me? And the Ribbono Shelem, in fact, leased it to me, lent it to me. And I am responsible to maximize it every moment of that potential. Am I allowed to give it away? Am I obligated to give it away? There'll always be objective criteria in the halacha that make that determination. That's what's unique about Yisrael, ki oragno lecha kol yom. It's not martyrdom to go out in a burst of glory. It's not martyrdom to have that self-satisfaction of being a martyr, which there is a Yetzer Hara for, as history testifies to. The Jew decries that. The Jew rejects that. The Jew says, there is a halacha. There are times, only three mitzvahs. One of them is Avodah Zarah. And amazingly enough, the youngest of the boys, is told by the hegemon, by this Caesar. He said, I'm going to throw down my seal. Make believe that you're bowing to the Avodah Zarah, but just bow down to pick up the seal. So then at least I can walk out of here with dignity that I haven't been bested by you children. And the boy looks at him and says, if you're so concerned about your covered, your honor, imagine what God's right is to be concerned about his covered, which is a real covered. Covered honor of the creator in relation to his creation, which means less than that relationship is dishonesty. Thus, the boy says, I won't. I won't comply. His mother asks just one moment before you take him out. She wants to kiss him. She takes this youngest of the boys and she says, you boys, your neshamas are going to Gan Eden. Give this message to Avraham Avinu. He brought one Akedah. I brought seven. He sacrificed one son. It's as if Yitzhak was sacrificed, right? It's as if the ashes are collected together at the Mizbeach. I, in fact, brought seven. So, Mefoshim say, she's trying to reestablish, I have not become blinded to the fact that I love these children. This is my son. He remains my son. I would prefer not to have to sacrifice him. I'm doing it because that's the halacha, and that is what I'm required to do. And Reb Chaim Shmulevitz, Zecher Tzadik Levracha, the Mira Rosh Yeshiva, said she wasn't trying to pull one-upmanship to say, Avram, you only sacrificed one, I sacrificed seven. She was saying to him, how is it possible for a simple Jewess such as myself to be so heroic? The answer is, you established that norm, you made that breakthrough, and because the DNA of your Mesiras Nefesh is in the soul of every Jew and Jewess, we can do so when we are required according to halachic criteria, not in an emotional explosion of ecstasy of martyrdom, but we're mechuyev. Otherwise, I have to protect my life and do more mitzvahs that the Rebbeinu Shem gave me the capacity to do. Rebbeinu Shem, again and again, sends these messages. We have there in the Gemara the 400 children that were taken for exploitation to Rome. And the girls ask, should we, if we jump into the ocean, should we do that? In which case, we will avert this degradation. Will our souls be retrieved? And the boy, the eldest of the boys, they ask, because he's the senior person there. He's the Meire de Asra. And they're going to, they want a decision with criteria, again, not emotionalism, not merely emotionalism. The boy says, yes, Darshan's a posik. And then he says, it's a kal v'chomer. It follows a fortiori that we have to be Mesa Nefesh as well, because they were taken for exploitation, we're being taken for perverted exploitation. And they're also Mesa Nefesh. Criteria, analysis, understanding, according to the objective reality, the same Ribbono Shlalom that authored the Torah and then created the world gave me the rules, the boundaries, where yes, where no. And in that sense, Chazal say, the mother of those seven sons, Eim Habonim Smecha, that she has a certain level of simcha, because she fulfilled the mandate of what she was here for and what she brought life to this world for. The Rebbeinu Shem Zehelfen, that our Mesiras Nefesh should be in the recitation of the Shema, in the willingness and not being tested, and we should see b'mheira b'yameinu b'yis ha'gail.
Eicha yu'am zahav yishne ha'kesem ha'toiv tishtapeich no'abnei kaidesh v'roish kol chutzois b'nei tziyoin ha'yikorim ha'mesuloim b'poz eicha nechshevu l'nivlei cheres.
There's a story about the Baal Shem Tov. This story concerns two children born in a small shtetl in Europe. Their houses were across the street from one another. They were good friends. They went to cheder to one another. When they grew up, they got married and lived very close to one another. One worked in the shtetl. The other became a kind of traveling salesman, and he was away from home at extended periods of time. On one trip, they knew his schedule, and they knew he was coming back, and the friend in the shtetl calculated that he was going to arrive back on his birthday. So he decided to make a surprise party for his friend, and he invited guests, and they arranged food in the traveling salesman's house. And when he arrived back from his trip, and he came in, of course, he was very surprised and very pleased. He walked in with a bag of money that he had earned in the trip in his hand. He put the money down on a bookshelf, and he started to circulate among the guests and express his gratitude. The friend from the shtetl thought putting the money down on the bookshelf and leaving it exposed was irresponsible. And he felt that his friend's family depended upon the money. Wouldn't be appropriate to take that kind of chance. When no one was looking, he took the bag of money and took it across the street to his own house, intending later to give it back to him and give him some mussar, that he took an unnecessary chance. Well, the party wore on and it got into the evening and people were still present. He didn't want to do this in front of others. So he went home and he thought, I'll spend a few hours at home. When everybody goes home, I'll come back to the house and I'll confront him. But he fell asleep. Came the next morning. The next morning, his friend was already in shul. The morning wore on. There was no time when the friend was alone. And he felt his strength leaving him. He felt his resolve waning to the point where he realized he wasn't going to give the money back. He felt terrible, but the friend had already reported the loss to the police, and the police promised an investigation, and now the risk was too great, and he realized that he'd been trapped, that the sultan had him trapped. Okay, so now he has this bag of money. What is he going to do with it? He couldn't just add it to the family income. How would he explain where the money came from? So he decided to pretend to go on a business trip of his own. And then he would spend the time in the countryside and come back and claim that this bag of money was what he had earned also. He hired a wagon and he drove out of the town, leaving the town behind him, and he felt like he was digging his own grave. At which point, the Baal Shem Tov was coming towards him in a wagon, and as the two wagons drove beside one another, Baal Shem Tov grabbed the reins of both and stopped both wagons so that he was sitting opposite the fellow from the shtetl, and he whispered in his ear, I know you meant it for good. Turn around. Go back. Admit it. And if there's a trial, I will come and testify on your behalf. And at that moment, the yid from the shtetl felt like his life had been saved. He regained the strength to go back, and he did admit to the crime. This is a story about tshuva, but it has a very important double message. Number one, the cause is never lost. It's never too late. HaKadosh Baruch Hu doesn't give up on a person and promises the person help. It's not just that you can do it and turn things around, but if you make an effort, if you turn around and confront the problem, then HaKadosh Baruch Hu will help you. In the story, the Baal Shem Tov plays the role of the Divine Providence, the Hashgacha Protis, that says, if you need help to make it successful, I will make it successful. We say this in Tefillah. We say in the Shemona Esrei, Achzireinu b'shuva shleima lefanecha. Many ask, isn't Shuvah something that I have to do? What does it mean that I'm asking a Kodesh Baruch Hu to, so to speak, do my tshuva, to bring me back in tshuva? That falsifies the whole mission. The key word, according to some Mefarshim, is the word shlema. Yes, I have to do tshuva, but I haven't got the strength to complete it. I can't finish it. I can't make it shalem. Kodesh Baruch Hu says, you start, and I'll help you make it shalem. This commitment to the individual that he'll get siyata d'shamaya in enabling him to make a complete tshuva is a theme that you find throughout all Torah sources. It's a principle of Musar, repeated over and over again, that either you're going up or you're going down. There's no neutral position. There's no static position. Either you're going up or you're going down. And one of the images that the Musar sources communicate is the image of a fish, and you want to know whether the fish is alive or dead. So you throw it into a moving stream. If it goes upstream, then it's surely alive. If it goes downstream, it's probably floating with the current, and it's probably dead. I want to ask a question about this image. Suppose I take the fish and throw it into a moving stream and remains at the same point in the water. Is it alive or dead? It's got to be alive. Because if it were dead, it would be floating downstream. Is it really true that either you're going up or you're going down? Here's another point. In the Gemara, we have a phrase, Yerida L'tzorech Aliyah. That means that when you're going down, it's a preparation for the next step up. So when you're going down, it's preparation for the next step up. Are you going down or are you going up? If this is what you need to take the next step up, how can you say that the person's going down, deteriorating? The truth, as I have spoken to Baali Musar about it, the truth seems to be that the idea that you're going up or down is not in chitzonius, it's in pnimius. There are times when a person undertakes a new mitzvah and circumstances make it too hard for him to continue and he has to pull back. That's not going down. That's going up, because the person is investing in his future. He's building his future. He's building his future by retreating in practice so as to gain more strength to be able to go up. That means that HaKadosh Baruch Hu promises us, as long as we are fighting, as long as we are spiritually alive, then we are still on an aliyah, which is what the Baalei Musar would say. I used to teach in Elul, my Talmidim. Of course, a person fails and fails repeatedly, and he thinks, what good will Yom Kippur be this year because I failed so many times, went through so many Yom Kippurim. And I used to say, it's a year later. And since it's a year later, you're not the same person, and you should have hope that you'll be able to succeed. Until I read the Siva Shalom. And the Siva Shalom says, the fact that you're still fighting, the fact that you haven't given up, means that you're spiritually alive. And it means you're not a failure. You're trying. You care. You haven't been misyayish. You, which is the great enemy, as all the Svarim say, the Chassidus Svarim, the Musa Svarim, if you haven't given up, you're still spiritually alive. This is for the individual. It's also true for Klal Yisrael. It's true for the Bria as a whole. Kodesh Baruch Hu put Olam HaChav in Gan Eden. When they failed, they were expelled from Gan Eden, and the whole world was deteriorated. The Ramchal speaks about this at length. The whole world went down to a degraded, it lost its grade, went down to a degraded state. The way he puts it is, the Ruchnius in Gan Eden became inaccessible to us. The Gashmius in Gan Eden is parallel to our Ruchnius. And our Gashmius was brand new. It didn't exist in the period of Gan Eden. What did HaKadosh Baruch Hu do to us and for us in this deteriorated world? He gave us chance after chance to make it back. Ramchal says, Nadir Hashem, that up until Avraham Avinu, the period what he calls Shorashim of roots, every person could have done what Avraham Avinu did. The whole world could have recovered that connection to Gan Eden and recovered that original process. Only Avraham Avinu did it. After that came the period of Umos, the Shivim Umos. Any Uma or portion of an Uma could have detached itself and joined Avraham Avinu with Klal Yisrael. At Har Sinai, the Medrash tells us that HaKadosh Baruch Hu offered the Torah to all the nations of the world, not in place of us. Ein davar kaze. The whole world was waiting for Klal Yisrael to accept Yom HaShishi, to accept the Torah at Sinai. But in addition to us, the whole world could have been Mekabel Torah together with us. Just as in the Mabul, generation of the Mabul, B'shagam hu basar, say Chazal, B'shagam is Moshe Rabbeinu, there could have been a Matan Torah in the door of the Mabul. But it was rejected. And even now, Geirus means that a person recovers that status by coming a Yid. becoming a member of Klal Yisrael. The Shem Yishmuel goes even further. The Gemara says, Kuli Alma Modi the B'Shabbos Nitna Torah. The Torah was given on the day of Shabbos. One Tana says, Hosif Moshe Rabbeinu Yom Echad Midatu. He added one day on his own. Because Baruch Hu said, prepare yourself for 3 days and I'll give the Torah on the third day. Moshe Rabbeinu said, prepare yourself for 3 days. The Torah will come on the fourth day. And of course, Baruch Hu said, okay, you added one day, I'll add one day. So, according to that das, what day was the Torah supposed to be given on? Because Baruch Hu wanted to give the Torah on Friday. Why on Friday? Says the Shem Yishmuel, because Adam HaRishon was created on Friday. And when we stood at Sinai, the Pasuk says, Ani amarti elokim atem, uvnei elyon kuchem. I said, you are like HaKadosh Baruch Hu, children of the Most High, immortal, say Chazal. Immortal, without death. HaKadosh Baruch Hu was setting up the conditions of Gan Eden all over again. And there was a Nachash, the Erev Rav was a Nachash. They were the ones who led to the Chet of the Egel, which is parallel to the Eitz Hadas. The whole thing was set up as a repeat in order to be able to pass the test this time, instead of failing the test as it was the first time. Because Baruch Hu didn't give up on us. What did Moshe Rabbeinu want by pushing it on to Shabbos? Shabbos, say Chazal, is Kviyah Bekaima. Shabbos is something which is established only from a Kodesh Baruch Hu's side, which means that whatever a Kodesh Baruch Hu does on Shabbos is permanent. Moshe Rabbeinu said to Ribbono Shel Olam, it's a wonderful thing to try again. We'll do our best to meet the challenge, but what happens if we fail? When Adam and Chava failed, you kicked them out of Gan Eden. If Klal Yisrael fails, does that mean that they're going to be rejected? The connection with you is going to be severed? I don't want that. I want to have an insurance policy. Do it on Shabbos, so that even if they fail, they'll still be connected. Kodesh Baruch Hu agreed. Kodesh Baruch Hu said that Chizkiyahu HaMelech could have been Mashiach. Kodesh Baruch Hu is making repeated efforts to recover for the world what it lost. Kodesh Baruch Hu doesn't give up on us. Doesn't give up on us as individuals. It doesn't give up on us as a klal. That means that that's the hope that we have, that eventually we can be successful. It is natural, after thousands of Tisha B'Av, to think, how is it possible? How is it possible? How are we any better than the previous generations? That's not our cheshbon. It's not a cheshbon that we're allowed to make, certainly not competent to make. On the contrary, Kodesh Baruch Hu says, I didn't give up on you, and therefore we have no right to give up on ourselves. I think the origin of this idea is in the idea that Kodesh Baruch Hu made us shutofim b'maisa breishis. He made us partners in maisa breishis. The Medrash in Shir Shirim says this in a very dramatic fashion. The Melech says to his beloved, Zos Tamasi, she's my pure one. Says the Medrash, don't read Tamasi, read Te'omasi, my twin. Chai Yisrael is a Nivra. The Ribbono Shel Olam, the Borei Olam says, this Nivra is my twin. And in case you didn't get it, the Medrash goes on, Lo Ani Gedol Mimena, Lo Hi Gedol Mimeni. I'm not bigger than she, she's not bigger than I. That's shocking. Says the Ramchal and Das Tfunos, we are both necessary for the perfection of the world. The world will not reach its perfection without the human contribution. And in that way, we have that equivalence of both being necessary. Of course, he does 99.9999%, and we do 0.001%, but we're both necessary. In that fashion, we're made shutofim b'maisa breishis. Now, if we are shutofim b'maisa breishis, that means that the way HaKadosh Baruch Hu made breishis is not complete. It's not perfect. It's not finished. How did he do that? There are two different ways to do that. One is start the project and leave it unfinished. And then what happens has to happen is it becomes finished. There's another way to do it. Make it all the way to the end, finish it, make it perfect, and then break it. Break it. Then what you have to do to make it perfect is to repair something broken. And that's what HaKadosh Baruch Hu did. And that's what it means. Borei Olamos v'Machrivan. He created worlds and destroyed them. He created a whole plan, a whole set of machshava of what the world should look like in its ideal. And then he developed strategies to bring it into practice. Part of the strategy was taking a certain structure and breaking it. and then repairing it partially and leaving for us to repair the rest. We can't create anything new. There's no Bria Yesh Me'ayin after the Bria of the 7 days. That being the case, we're only recovering what was there before, just like the famous Medrash that the fetus learns all the Torah of the womb, so that when you learn Torah in your lifetime, you're remembering what you learned once, because if you had to learn it fresh, you would never be able to do that. You're not capable of doing that fresh. So the world also was given to us broken, and our charge, our challenge is to recover the completeness of it. That being the case, it means HaKadosh Baruch Hu gave us the completeness as a reality. Nothing in history is ever lost. HaKadosh Baruch Hu made it complete, it means that completeness is part of the world, part of the background in which we work, and we're just climbing back up the ladder to get to the completeness that was there before. And I think, and with this I'm going to finish, I think that we see some of this. HaKadosh Baruch Hu in the last 60 years, since the end of the Shoah, has shown us his hashgacha to give us a prelude of the completeness that we're working for. The reemergence of Klal Yisrael from the Shoah, if you've studied the Shoah, if you understand the condition that Klal Yisrael was in, I don't think anyone could foresee 60 years later the great yeshivas that the world has and the great chassidus that the world has. Hundreds of thousands of people. More people are learning Torah, a bigger percentage of people learning Torah, they say, than any time since Bayis Sheni. And the recovery of Rishonim and Acharonim, the Tosfos HaRosh, the Meiri. I read Rav Dessler, he wrote a letter when he heard that the text of the Maharal on Chiddush Yagodos was going to be published. He said, is it really true? How do they know it's genuine? And get me one. Today every bar mitzvah bacher gets one. Kadosh Baruch Hu is opening up for us the chesed that he wants to show us in the recovery of that shleimus. And the yishuv in Eretz Yisrael, something we didn't have in 1900 years, the fact that Torah lives in Eretz Yisrael and mitzvahs lives with the challenges and with the compromises that the majority population requires of us, but it's a yishuv that's something that we didn't have for 1900 years. Kadosh Baruch Hu is telling us, here, I'm opening the door, some rays of light can be visible. You can see them coming into the room. The room isn't entirely dark. That's the encouragement that he's giving us, that not only do we know from the sources that he never gives up on us, but he's showing us that he's present now to give us a helping hand. What we need to do is take that hand, turn around, learn the lesson of the Baal Shem Tov, that HaKadosh Baruch Hu is just waiting for us to make our move, and he will testify for us that all the things that we failed at, we didn't fail at them out of pesha, out of rebellion. We failed because Mima Akev Sor Shebe'isa, the Yetzirah overwhelmed us. And HaKadosh Baruch Hu will help us create that shleimus that we're all hoping for.
Hashiveinu Adonai Elecho v'noshuvo Chadei Shameinu Kikedem.